turns into the possible. And so, Lord, we just give you praise today. And we do acknowledge this morning that your ways are better than our ways. Help us, Lord, to embrace your ways, because we know that you said that the kingdom of God is more than just eating and drinking, but it's about righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Spirit. And we just speak life today, Lord. We speak that peace. We speak righteousness to our world, to the circumstances and situations around us. We receive your peace. We walk in your joy, because we know that your joy is our strength. And Father, we just thank you for your presence being here today to give us hope when the world around doesn't seem like it has much, but we know our future, we know what you've created for us, and we know our destiny. And we give you praise today in Jesus' name. Amen? Amen. Well, give the Lord a good praise today. Tell him thank you. You may be seated. So great to see you out today. Hope you're having a good week and it'll even be better. All right. Well, if you have your hand out there, let's just jump right in this morning, get rolling. And this week will be part two of my message titled Pack Your Bags. If you didn't hear last week's, I encourage you to do that. If nothing else, you can go on there and watch a couple fun videos, you know, fishing and stuff. So anyway, get a chance. I encourage you to do that. This message, what we've been talking about is learning to pack your bags for a successful life's journey, and realize that no matter where you are on the journey, whether you're just beginning your journey, you're just new to the Christian faith, or you're a seasoned traveler, we always have to evaluate along the way what should or should not be packed in our travel bag. Because we don't need the baggage or the bag we are carrying to be the burden and be heavier than life itself. Because life, as we all know, can be a big burden. So we don't want our bag to be heavy as life. Last week we were reminded that the biblical view of life for us as followers of Christ must be from a spiritual and an eternal mindset, not a temporal one. We all need to realize that the life we're living is temporary. The things that are important that we seem to be important in our lives, those things can be many times temporary. So we need to have a mindset on the things that God says. You know, we found out in the book of Hebrews about those who went before us. It says that they had this attitude that they were strangers traveling through time and history with no permanent home on earth. They had their sights set on the heavenly destination, not on things of this world. The Apostle Paul tells us in Colossians to set your mind on things above. Remember, life is the journey. It is not the destination. So when we are looking at packing our bags, we need to keep in mind that not all of our journeys in life are the same, because each of us has a different and a unique purpose for which we were born, but our destination is the same. We are all headed in that one direction. We all need certain things in our life suitcase to help us as we encounter the uncertainties in life. God is going to put different things in your life that you're going to need for your destination on this earth, your purpose, but there are many things that are very similar. I'm going to talk about one of those this morning. One very important advantage that we have over the unbelieving world is that we have access to the one person who knows the future, to the one person who can reveal anything he wishes to you and to me at any time that he believes that you need in order to make your journey more successful. So what does that mean? That means that as long as we are willing to follow, the Father will always guide us lead us, and be with us. Look at your neighbor and say, in this journey, I'm not alone. So what should be in our bag? That's the question. What should we pack in our bag to enjoy a fruitful life journey with eternal consequences, good consequences? Well, this morning, I actually brought a bag. And this bag has been with me for a few years. This bag was given to me 40 years ago when I joined the military, when I became a member of the United States Air Force. So when I was in basic training, this was one of the first things that you got, because they realized that in the military, in your military journey, you're going to need a bag, and it's going to need to be packed with certain things. The first thing, this is called a MOBAG, or a mobility bag. And in this bag, I put all my stuff. And it was interesting, when I got to basic, when I got out of basic training and I went to my duty station where I was going to be stationed for a number of years, we were told exactly what needed to be packed in that particular bag in case of an emergency, in case we were mobilized and had to go jump on an airplane and go somewhere else and defend our country or whatever needed to be done. So there were specific things that were put in this bag that we were to carry with us, a number of uniforms, boots, socks, undergarments, all of these different things, obviously some civilian clothes. So everything you had was packed in this bag. And I have to tell you a funny story. So the whole time I was there, most of the time when I was in the military, we were always playing games, playing war games, and we never got to really do anything with it. So we were constantly, the sirens would go off on the base. You'd reach down, you'd grab your bag, head to your particular squadron where you were, went through all the stuff, you go through all these steps in one station, and they check this to make sure you have that and all this, and finally you walk out of the hangar, and you know, usually there's no plane there. But this time we did it, we walked out of the hangar, and bang, there was a plane. So we're like, oh, this should be fun. So we all loaded on the plane, we get on the plane, and that's when they tell us, okay, this is where we're headed. This is what's going on, and blah, blah, blah. So we jump on this airplane, head to another part of the world. One of the guys got on the plane, and he looks at me, and he said, Cunningham? I go, yeah. He goes, man, I won't repeat the word that he used. But basically, he was not in good shape. And I go, why? He goes, because all that is in my MOBAG is newspaper. I'm like, what? He goes, yeah, man, you know how many times we're never really going anywhere. We're always playing war, but we never take off and go anywhere. So I figured this was just the same. I just thought we were playing, so all of my uniforms and everything are in my room. The only uniform he had was what he was wearing. So we got on a plane and headed overseas, and this guy had nothing. He had nothing. So he literally had to find a way to ship it and to get uniforms. He wore the same uniform probably for like 2 weeks because he had nothing. He didn't have anything. And none of us were giving him anything because that we were required to have it. So it's so important. How many of you agree with me? It's important to understand what is necessary to be in your bag, even when you don't think you're going to need it. And that's what we're talking about. So what would be the first thing that we need in our bag? Last week I had you pull out your sheet and you wrote some things down. And I kind of did that just to give you an idea. But this morning I'm going to talk about what is the most important. What I consider to be and what was most important to the military and to us when we were doing it was right here, right on this side. The most important thing that we needed in our bag was our identification. Was our identification. On our dog tags, as they were called, on the dog tag, it had my name, Cunningham Andrew A., my Social Security number, my blood type, and my religion. And mine was Christian. Some people would put Catholic or Baptist or whatever, but that was on all of our dog tags. I actually had a military ID that had who I was. But the most important thing we needed in our bag was to know who we were. They needed to be able to identify us. We used to laugh that the dog tag was really only there just so once we got blown up or whatever, they just tie it to whatever piece was left and they could identify us that way. But really, those were, no joke, but that really was, it's important for us to understand who we are. The dictionary defines identity as the fact of being who or what a person is, which you would think that's kind of elementary, but that is important to understand who we are. The question that we want to answer today is, who are you? Who are you? I know this morning you can reach in your pocket or your purse and you can pull out a driver's license and you can attach that name and you can look at that. But is that really who you are? Who are you? What defines you? Well, let's take a look at this video this morning and see if we can find out who defines you and who you are. That's the question this morning. Who are you? Who are you? What defines you? You know, people today have all kinds of challenges in their life that are directly related to their identity. People have identity crisis. They don't know who they are. People deal with identity theft in the natural sense. We deal with mistaken identity. The identity Your identity is what determines who you are. You can't do anything without an ID. You can't do anything without proving who you are. You know, I've heard many stories of people who have lost their memory. You can go online. It's amazing. You can type in losing your memory, and it'll give you story after story of people who, for whatever reason, have lost their memory, couldn't remember literally who they were. Imagine if that were you this morning. That you are here this morning with friends, people you know, maybe some you like, some you don't like, but you know who they are. Something traumatic happens today and immediately tomorrow, you wake up and you don't even know who you are. You have no identity. No past, no present, no connections, no friends. You do not know who you are. You can't remember anything. Your entire identity has been erased. That would be a very scary experience to have no identity and no recollection of who you are. We know even today's world, there are movies that are made about that. There are one big trilogy, the Jason Bourne series of movies is all based on the fact that this guy lost his memory. He spends five movies trying to figure it out. Yeah, if you like that. So it took him a while, but after five movies and different parts of the world, he kind of figured out who he was. You know, but that is the challenge. people may have a name, they may have something in their of their ID, but the question is, do they really know who they are? What is that? And I think that's exactly where a lot of people are this morning, not just here, but all over the world. They don't really know who they are. They walk around every day in a human body. They breathe air. They have jobs. They work. They do all the things that everybody does, but they're still searching for themselves, so to speak. So the question this morning we want to look at and we want to be able to determine is who we are. My goal today is to help you find yourself. You know, people travel the world trying to find themselves. When in reality, they just need to stop, talk to their Creator. Because once we meet our Creator, we'll be able to find out who we are. We live in a world right now where people have a sense, a longing to belong. They want to be important. They want to be somebody. They want to connect with other people. They want to have value. And listen, that value and worth are connected to who you are. Your value and worth is connected to who you are. We all want to be important, feel sense of value in who we are. Well, I want to encourage you to let you know that you can stop searching. You can stop looking. The answer to our search for significance is found in the Bible, but here's the deal, and I have to be honest with you. There is an enemy, and we have an enemy who is constantly day in and day out trying to keep you from finding out who you are. And if you do find out who you are, he is trying to constantly steal your identity and keep you from living out the result and the benefit of knowing who you are. Satan does not want you to discover your true identity. He wants you to be confused about your identity. We are living in a world right now, visibly, where people don't know who they are. I could get into all of the ways, and we know it out there right now. There's all kinds of problems with people because they don't know who they are. They are looking for someone else to identify them instead of to the God that created them. They don't know who they are. They're confused. Satan is the biggest identity thief there is. The Bible tells us that he came to steal, kill, and destroy. So he is going to destroy. He's going to steal your identity. Who in here has not heard of identity theft? Obviously, we have. Here's some news. According to the 8 group, is what it's called, 47% of Americans experienced financial identity theft in 2020. 47%. The group's report found that losses from identity theft cases cost, look at what it said, $502.5 billion in 2019. It went up, it increased 42% in the year 2020, and now it is costing the American population $712.4 billion in identity theft. Going on. COVID hit. People took advantage of the situation and began to find all kinds of ways to steal people's identity. Every 79 seconds, a case of identity theft is reported in the United States. It's a challenge. I look at that as a reflection of what's going on in the spirit with people's lives. People need to understand who they are, and once they find out who they are, they need to do everything they can to protect their identity. Protect who you are. So what does the Bible say? What does the Bible say about who you are and what God's plan is for your life? The Bible teaches that we have to have an identity change before we can reach our destiny. Okay, what does that mean? Well, look at that. In other words, your destiny is connected to your identity. Think about that for a while. I'll tell you a story. Since we're talking about military stuff. And it was funny, this week, I happened to think of this. My dad and I were going through photos and pictures and stuff, and I remembered a story. There was a guy I was in basic training with. His name was Burke. And he was probably about 26, 27 years old at that time. And I was next to him. I bunked right next to him. He slept there. I slept here. And there was something, you know, definitely different with this dude. He was constantly like irritated all the time. He was always seemed like he was going to explode and get mad about something. And so I was always trying to keep the guy calm down. So I share the scripture with him, and I talk to him about the Lord. I'm like, yeah, he'd go, yeah, no, that's what I need to do. And so all these different things. And then next thing I know, one day we're all sitting around doing whatever we were doing, shining our shoes, boots, or whatever. And my drill instructor, who is a Christian man, called him into the office. And then after a minute or so, he opens the door and he calls in Sergeant Gibson, which was the assistant drill instructor, and they both go in there, and they're in maybe 10, 15 minutes. Next thing you know, the military police show up, they handcuff this guy, and they walk out. And we're all standing around, what in the world just happened? Well, come to find out, Sergeant Gibson tells us that a week or so before that, Sergeant Solaire, which he was a Christian man, felt like the Lord gave him an unction and said to him, Burke is not Burke. What? So he called him into the office and he began to research all the different things and found out that the Airman Burke didn't remember how to write his last name. Sometimes he would write B-U-R-K-E, sometimes he would write B-U-R-K, so that became a red flag. He called him into his office. My drill instructor looked right at Airman Burke and says to Burke, he goes, you're not Burke, are you? And he told him, you spell your name K-E, you spell your name K, so I know you're not Burke. Why don't you tell me who you are? The guy came right out and told him who he was. Told him what happened. Come to find out, the guy had broken out of prison in California. He escaped prison in California. He went to Washington, up to Seattle, ended up getting a fake birth certificate, fake ID, fake everything, joined the military, and God caught him through my drill instructor listening to the Lord's voice. How many of you agree with me that your destiny is connected to your identity? Because Burke had a different destiny because of who he was. So the Bible has a lot to say about the battle for our identity. And if you want to understand your identity, then we need to understand the Bible's message. Among many things in the Bible, one of the things that's unique is that the Bible really is basically a story about two guys. About this first man called Adam, and the second man that was born to the world called Jesus. And it's a connection to a certain group of people and their connection to Adam, and a certain group of people and their connection to Jesus Christ. Your identity and destiny are connected to one and the other. The Apostle Paul put it this way in Romans. He said, Adam's one sin brings condemnation for everyone, but Christ's one act of righteousness brings a right relationship with God and new life for everyone. Because one person disobeyed God, many became sinners, but because one person obeyed God, many will be made righteous. So in other words, Adam brought death, Jesus brought life. Adam's one sin affects every person in every nation. Why? Well, think about it this way, a couple ways to look at it. If you have a recording and you're a musician, a singer, a songwriter, and you do a recording, you have a master copy of this recording, but on that master copy, there's a flaw. On that master copy, there's a flaw in it somewhere. You can hear it. And so every single copy that is made after that is going to have what? It's going to have flaws. So because of what Adam and Eve did, every single one of us is born with a flaw. It's called sin. It is inside of our nature. What does that mean? That means we're all in Adam. We're all in Adam. Our identity was found in him. How is our identity found in him? Well, here we look at it in a natural sense. Before I was born, I was in my parents. My DNA, my blood, my identity, who I am in the body or the natural person is made up of them. They came from their parents and so forth all the way back to the beginning days of Adam. We all are connected genetically, DNA. Now they can research your ancestry and find out exactly where you came from because we're all connected. In Adam, in natural sense. That's why Jesus said while he was on earth that we have to be born again. If we want to change our destiny, we have to be born again. You could say it this way, your first natural birth puts you in Adam, but your new birth puts you in Christ. So if you want to change your destiny and you want to get out from under this curse of Adam and everything that comes with it, you have to make a decision so your destiny will change. Your new birth puts you in Christ. One is eternal. This physical body is temporary. The Apostle Paul makes this very clear. He said, your identity comes from one of two places, in Adam or in Christ. The Apostle Paul chose to be in Christ. So what does God say? What God said was, is basically like this. He says, the first humanity failed, so I'm going to send my son, Jesus Christ, and he's going to get in a body, and we're going to make a new kind of humanity, and I'm going to guarantee that this will never happen again. Because Jesus will never not obey me. The Bible calls Jesus the Son of God, and he also calls him the Son of Man. Jesus referred to himself as the Son of Man. Why? Because he represented both. He came in as the second Adam, but he also came in as a new creation, the Son of God. 1 Corinthians 15:44, the Apostle Paul said, the first Adam became a living being. The last Adam is a life-giving spirit. That's why it's important to understand this story. The Bible is this story about two men and their effects on humanity. So today, this morning, you're either in Adam or you're in Christ. There's no middle ground, for as in Adam all die, so in Christ all will be made alive. Paul is telling us and telling you and me, one man got us into this mess and another man got us out of this mess. One man got us into the mess, and he said, Jesus came to get us out of this mess. I like what the Apostle Paul said another way in Romans chapter 5 and verse 20 about Jesus and what he did for us. Romans 5:20, the last part of it says, but where sin abounded, grace did much more abound. We've probably heard that before, but you probably never heard it in the Lovitz translation, and it says this, it says, God's work in Christ far exceeds any damage done to us by Adam's fall. Isn't that awesome? See, the conflict for many of us is that we have gained our identity from our family backgrounds, our life circumstances that have defined us, our mistakes, our decisions, whether they were good or bad, who the culture says we are, who society says we are. Did you know that it does not matter what society says about you? Because eternally, that's not going to change anything, is it? What God says about you is more important than anything, anyone, any person, any community, any society would ever say about you, because that's eternal. That's what God wants you to see. In Adam we all die, in Christ we all live. Many times what happens is we stay stuck in who we are in Adam in our minds, even though we are in Christ. We're stuck in our mind in the old nature, in Adam, instead of experiencing new life that we can have in Christ. Making the decision to put your trust in Jesus Christ to be born again is the first step in finding your true identity. Knowing who you are, having your proper identification in your life's bag is going to help you in your destiny. If you don't know who you are, then how are you going to know where you're going? And why? When God tells you who you are, what plan he has for your life, it changes your purpose. Once you make that decision to find out who you are and your connection to Jesus Christ, it changes your destiny. That's the first steps towards God's plan in your life. The Apostle Paul put it this way, and this is a common phrase in us in Christianity, but when you look at it from understanding and being in Adam and being in Christ, it changes your thinking. In 2 Corinthians 5:17, it said, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. But what does the word new mean? You and I think new. You know, we have a lot of different things that go through our mind when we think new. Well, this particular word used, new, actually means fresh, novel, unused, new, as in form or quality. And this is what I love, something that never existed before. So no matter what you think about yourself, the day that you were born again, Jesus said that you go from death to life. You were not alive, but now you're alive. You never existed before, but now you do. Everybody look at your neighbor and say, I'm new. I mean it. I'm really new. The reason a person in Christ is something that never existed before is because Jesus, in his death, burial, and resurrection, listen, did something that had never been done before. No one had risen from the dead. And because of that, the Bible tells us that he was the first fruits of a new creation. You and I are a part of a new creation. When we become a Christian, we set the standard now for humanity. Instead of Adam setting the standard for humanity, Jesus started a brand new, whole new existence of humanity when we choose to embrace the message of the gospel. We get to experience Jesus Christ and God's creation in us in a different way. Listen, everything God did in Christ, he did in you. So in other words, whatever happened in Jesus happened in you. What's in Jesus is in you. And you may think, well, how's that? Because the Bible tells us we share the same spirit. So the term in Christ, even though we may not understand that, the term in Christ and its many expressions and forms of in him, in whom, etc., that we see used in the Bible is used 130 times. Depends on what translation of the Bible you're using. So if you want to know who you are, then you need to find out what's in Christ. When you see those words in him, through him, you need to stop and see what's in Christ because it's in you. The Bible tells us that we are the righteousness of God in Christ. The Bible tells us because of our relationship with Jesus Christ, we are a chosen people. We're a royal priesthood. We are above and not beneath. We are overcomers, not overcome. That is in our spirit. That is who we are. One of the greatest and clearest examples that we have in the Bible of a complete identity change before about it was about the Apostle Paul. And you can read that in Acts chapter 9. In Acts chapter 26. Before he became a Christian, his name was what? Saul. Saul was a Pharisee. He was a very devout religious man who went around persecuting Christians. The Bible tells us that he was on such a journey sent by his authorities to arrest and to imprison anyone that was found to be connected to Jesus Christ or was a Christian. While on this journey, the Bible tells us that he was hit by the glory of God. A bright light shined. He encountered Jesus Christ in a personal way. It blinded, literally blinded him for a number of days. One person said the power of God hit Saul so hard on the road that it knocked the S off of the front of his name and replaced it with a P. His name changed. His identity changed. His nature changed. Paul was a new person with a new identity. He got direct revelation from Jesus Christ after that event. The Bible tells us that he spent 10, 11, 12 years getting information from Jesus Christ. I believe the information that the Apostle Paul got from Jesus Christ and wrote it down were all of the things that Jesus told his disciples that you're not ready to hear yet. Jesus told his disciples, I have many things to say to you, but he said, you're not ready. I believe all of the many things that he wanted to say, he said them to the Apostle Paul after Paul got converted and Paul wrote them to you and I. All of the books of the Apostle Paul give us new insight to who we are because of what Jesus Christ has done. God is the master identity changer. He changes identities like crazy. We see that all through the Bible. Abraham and Sarah, both of their names were changed. One, Abraham's name was a religion. Originally, was anybody know? Abram. God changed it to Abraham and said, you're now going to become the father of many nations. So God's name to them changed their destiny. The Apostle Paul was so firmly committed and convinced that he was in Christ that he wrote a statement in Galatians chapter 2 that many of us read and we still can't comprehend its depth. But he said these words. He said, I have been crucified with Christ and I no longer live. But Christ lives in me. The life I now live in the body, I live by the faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. Another translation put it this way, and I love this. It says, I consider myself as having died. And now I'm enjoying a second existence, which is simply Jesus using my body. What an incredible revelation. Paul actually believed he was dead and that he was a new person in Christ. He wasn't experiencing some sort of stress-related mental delusion, nor was he talking about some spiritual state or a theological terminology. He believed in the here and now. He actually believed that when Jesus died on the cross, he died with him. And everything that he was experiencing in the present life was Jesus living in him and living through him. He saw himself in Christ, and he no longer saw himself in Adam. New existence, new person altogether. Now the question is, we ask, what does it mean? What does the term in Christ mean? To be in Christ. The Apostle Paul actually believed that it was an actual union that existed between Christ and a believer, whether we understand it or not. There is a connection between them, an inseparable connection in the Spirit between a person who receives Christ and Jesus himself that cannot be broken. There is a connection. He said, in 1 Corinthians, he that is joined to the Lord is one spirit. So that means what's in Jesus is in you. So what is our responsibility now? Now our responsibility, if you are a Christian, is to find every single place where you see the words in Christ, in him, through him. You need to stop when you're reading it and look and see what's in him, because that's in you. Even if you're not experiencing it, even if you're not visibly seeing it, doesn't matter, it's there. Because isn't that what faith is? Faith believes in things that are not sometimes visible, but they are real. Would you agree with me that the Spirit is real? How many of you see it right now? We can at times, but many times we're living in the natural. This is what we see. But we know the unseen is eternal, and the seen is temporary. I want to challenge you to go discover who you are. What's in Christ is in you. Look, everything that God says about us in Christ are not potentials or even promises. They are facts and realities. It's a fact. It's a fact, whether you know it or not, whether you're aware of it, whether you believe it, doesn't make any difference. It's a fact. What's in Jesus is in you. We just need to discover how to get it from here inside of our spirit out into our natural self so that it becomes very real to everybody around us. The problem that we face, the problem many Christians have today, is that they've allowed the devil to steal their identity. They've allowed the devil in a deceptive ways to look outside of Jesus Christ to find their identity. So they're searching everywhere to try to find their identity, find who they are. They look to this person. I want to be like that guy. I want to be Superwoman, or I want to be Superman, or I want to be that person or this person. So they begin to develop themselves based on all these things they see, instead of looking to God and his word to determine who they are. That's our confusion. When we come to peace with God and peace with who we are, then we begin to discover our destiny in a unique and fulfilling way. Remember, Satan is a liar. And once you discover who you are, he works hard to steal your true identity. Protect your identity. Look at your neighbor and say, protect your identity. One thing I know is true. Everything changes when you understand who you are in Christ. When you understand who you are in Christ, you can embrace the words. One of the most famous quotes or statements the Apostle Paul has made, and we see it many times in many different places, this statement in Philippians 4:13, it says, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Why did he say that? Because he believed Jesus lived in him and that there was nothing impossible for him when Jesus was in him. Challenge you today, read the Word of God and find out who you are. I want to leave you this morning with an interesting story that relates to what I'm trying to share with you today. And it goes like this. It says, while walking through the forest one day, an old farmer found a young eagle who had fallen out of his nest. He took it home, he put it in his barnyard where it soon learned to eat and behave like the chickens. One day a stranger passed by the farm, and he asked the old man, why is it that the king of all birds should be confined to live in the barnyard with the chickens? The farmer replied that since he had given it chicken feed and had been around all the chickens and trained to be a chicken, it had never learned to fly. And since it now behaved as a chicken, it was no longer an eagle. But he still has the heart of an eagle, replied the stranger, and can surely be taught to fly. So he lifted the eagle toward the sky and said, you belong to the sky and not to the earth. Stretch forth your wings and fly. The eagle, however, was confused. He did not know who he was, and seeing the chickens eating their food, he jumped down to be with them again. The stranger took the bird to the roof of the house and urged him again, saying, you're an eagle. Stretch forth your wings and fly. But the eagle was afraid of his unknown self and the world around him, and he jumped down once more to be with the chickens. Finally, the stranger took the eagle out of the barnyard to a high mountain. There he held the king of the birds high above him and encouraged him again, saying, you are an eagle. You belong to the sky. Stretch forth your wings and fly. The eagle looked around, looked back towards the barnyard and up to the sky. Then the stranger lifted him straight towards the sun, and it happened that the eagle began to tremble. Slowly he stretched forth his wings and with a triumphant cry soared away into the sky. It may be that the eagle still remembers the chickens every now and then. It may even be that he occasionally revisits the barnyard when he's hungry. But as far as anyone knows, he has never returned to lead the life of a chicken. So this morning, that's us. It's our decision, your decision, my decision. What life do we want to live? The one that God in Christ has created for us to experience, or remain in a world in Adam that's limited and our destiny is unknown. But with Christ, we have a great life. Can you say amen? Amen. Amen. Well, let's stand together. And next week, we are going to look at the second thing in our bag that we need to be successful in this life and in our destiny. So don't miss it. Make sure you come back. And we'll discover the second thing that we need. Let's pray together. Father, this morning, I pray that you would grant unto us a clear revelation of what you have done for us in Christ. Help us to protect our new identity from the evil one by gaining knowledge of the truth that you have given us in your words. Even though We may not understand these things with our natural mind. Help us to see these facts as the new reality of our lives and of our destiny. Do not let us any longer look to the world around us or to past experiences to find our dignity, our worth, and our value, because we are no longer in Adam, but we are in Christ. Help us, Lord, today to experience and embrace the new life that we have in Christ. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Well, God bless you. Have an awesome day, and we will see you again soon.
I'm sure that everybody does. And I wonder when I stumble, am I still worthy of your love?